doesn't seem like this could possibly be true.
All right, well, good evening, everyone. It's nice to see, well, to kind of see you. Yeah, to see your eyes, your lovely eyes. We are glad that you were able to join us tonight, and we're just going to take some time just to focus our attention on God, to love on him, to worship him, and we can come with expectation that he's going to meet us where we're at. He's already in us. And he wants to speak. He wants to change and to bring peace and joy, just who he is, into this place. So I just invite you to stand and to join us as we enter into a time of worship.
And Verse 5 says, "Why are you in despair, O my soul? Why are you disturbed within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him for the help of my countenance and my God." Our hope does not come from the World Health Organization. Our help does not come from the state government, the federal government. Our hope does not come from a vaccine or the CDC or anybody or anything. Our hope comes from the Lord our God. Amen? Our hope comes from Jesus Christ from heaven on high. So don't be in despair. Don't be downcast. Don't be troubled. Do not worry. God knows what he's doing. Amen? All right. Remember, who's old enough to know? Who is it that is spoken of? Who is it referenced to? Who is that masked man? Who is that? The Lone Ranger. You know, the Lone Ranger came out during the Depression. The Lone Ranger came out during the darkest of times in our country, a man in a mask, to lift up the spirits of the people who were listening. Let's pray. God, thank you that in days like this, in times like this, in days of the mask, we can look up and hope in you, knowing that there is nothing that is against us if you are for us. And we do hope in you. Thank you, oh God. You are welcome in this place. What a holy moment. In Jesus' name, amen. So good to see you. Turn around, say hi to someone, wave, do whatever you want. Yep, yep. Say, nice mask. M95? Okay, have a seat just for a moment. Just a couple of things to keep in mind. The first of which is thank you for participating, cooperating, helping us to honor that which has come down upon us with the masks. Now, you'll notice that those on the platform leading and speaking don't have masks on. That is for clarity's sake. That is for your benefit. But they'll all put them on when they get off, okay? We're in this thing together. That makes sense? That okay? All right. This too shall pass. And by the way, we are receiving communion in a little while. And how many people, did you not receive one of these cups? Who didn't get one? Raise your hand, we'll have it brought to you. Does everyone have one of these cups? We'll receive communion later on at the end of service, okay? And by the way, we had, I heard there was a great youth virtual retreat right out here. They had a great week this week. God's doing great things in our midst and in our days, okay? Those of you that that normally give their offerings during our worship service, there's a plate back there. Those of you that are listening online, either Sunday or throughout the week, we appreciate your giving. Go ahead online or send something in the mail. We just know that God is faithful and God is using you to continue the ministry of the church, both here and around the world. You ready to worship God more? Let's stand together.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness soared through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Sing, who could imagine?
Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise, your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on.
Then came the morning.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Oh, Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah, praise the set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living
me to repentance. Your goodness, it draws me to your side. Your mercy, It calls me to be like you. Your favor, it is my delight. And every day I'll awaken my praise and pour out a song from my heart. You kindness, it leads me to repentance. Your goodness, it draws me to your side. Your mercy, it calls me to be like you. And your favor, it is my delight. And
will you pray with me? Thank you, God, for your goodness in our lives. I pray that you'd open our eyes to that. Pray, God, we'd be able to see and perceive your amazing grace, your goodness that is poured out to us, your compassion, your blessings, your mercies that are new every day. Help us to know that and understand that, God, at deeper levels today. As we come to worship you, as we approach your word today, help us to keep that in mind, that you are always good, only good, forever good. all the time. And so we bless you for that. In return, we praise you. We worship you. We trust in you. We put our lives in your hands because you are good. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, God bless you. Have a seat. What a great worship team. Wow. Praise the Lord. Oh, that's, please stop. Hey, it's so good to see you in church this evening, or today, I should say, because online it might be Sunday. Good to see you today. If you're watching and listening online, talking to the camera right now, because that's where all those people are, welcome. We're glad that you joined us. We are going through the book of James. So if you haven't been with us for a while or you haven't tuned in for a while, that's where we're at. Today we're in chapter 4, and I'm titling the message today, Fight the Right Fight. Fight the Right Fight. Look at the first part of the first verse of chapter 4 in James. James says this, what causes quarrels, fights, and quarrels among you? So here's a question for you. Do you have conflict in any of your relationships? In your marriage, or family, or work, or school, or heaven forbid, church? James is actually writing to church people. He's writing to Christians. And that's his question. What causes fights and quarrels among you? To dwell in love with the saints above, that will be glory. But to dwell below with the saints below, well, that's another story. Okay? There was a pastor that was speaking at a marriage retreat about resolving conflict. And at the end of the retreat, he was giving out small wooden crosses to each married couple. And he said, you know, place this cross in the room in your home where you fight the most, and you'll be reminded about God's commands, and you won't argue as much. And the wife looked at the pastor and said, you better give me 5. The math of conflict, 3 children plus 2 cookies equals a fight. You know, it's the same with adults and with many other things besides cookies. With more than one person, you'll always have more than one opinion, more than one personality, more than one set of goals and desires, more than one preference, more than one objective, more than one ambition. In today's world, and I would say especially in today's world, there's a lot of tension and there's plenty of reasons for us to disagree. You don't even have to try. There's pressures and there's opinions around us, around the pandemic and around racism and around politics. I want to tell you today that it's okay to fight as long as you fight the right fight. And James wants to help us by understanding 2 things as we break down the message today in chapter 4. Conflicts cause and conflicts cure. Okay, these will help us fight the right fight as we kind of work our way through it. And as we go through that, I want you to understand something. You know, it sounds like in the first part of verse 1 in chapter 4 that he's basically talking about how people get along together and the conflict that we have in our human relationships. But as James develops the idea, you'll see that he's also talking about, you know, how we connect with God. Because those 2 things are correlated. And those 2 things are interrelated. And those 2 things are connected. So I like to, when I see a picture of a cross, it reminds me that my vertical relationship is my most important relationship. But my vertical relationship impacts my horizontal relationships. And the health of my vertical relationship is going to be directly correlated to the health of my horizontal relationships. Okay, so they're connected, and as we develop this idea out in James chapter 4, I want you to understand that, you know, in the beginning it kind of sounds like, you know, having conflict with other people, but it's really, how do we get along with God? How do we connect well with God so that we can connect well with others? So let's look at conflict's cause, And it goes like this: the source of conflict is internal. I like this little saying: the heart of the problem is a problem of the heart. The heart of the problem with conflict is a problem of the heart. James chapter 4, the first three verses. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle where? Within you. You want something, but you don't get it. You kill and covet, but you cannot have what you want. You quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. So, in these verses, and just kind of leave that set of verses up there, because I want you to see there's a lot of self in here. It's very sort of self-ish. I like the word self-ish because it's very descriptive. And I see three different selves up here. I see self-centeredness, self-sufficiency, and self-consumption. Self-centeredness. James says, you want something, but you don't get it. I want my way. That causes conflict. Self-sufficiency. You don't have because you don't ask. What he's saying there is, you're saying you don't need God. When you don't go to God for things, it's like, you know, talk to the hand, God. I got this. No worries. Self-sufficiency, you don't have because you don't ask. And then the third self is self-consumption. You ask wrongly to spend it on your own passions. There's a lot of selfishness in there. Self-consumption is really hedonism. It's kind of making pleasure the main goal in life. And this, of course, negatively impacts your relationship with God and your relationship with others. So first, the source of conflict is internal. Secondly, the source of conflict can also be external. Continuing in James 4, verse 4, he says, you adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world is hatred toward God? So do you see how it's all kind of connecting here, also with your relationship with God? Anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think the scripture says without reason that the spirit he caused to live in us envies intensely? So in the world, there's influence, there's pressures, there's forces that are external, and they impact our lives if we're not careful. The word that James uses for world there in the Greek is the word cosmos or cosmos. Like, literally speaking, that would be like planet Earth and the other planets and the stars. That's the cosmos. But figuratively speaking, that's how James is using it here, it's the world system that excludes God. So what he's saying is that this can influence you and pressure you and force you and impact you. It's kind of like what Jesus was talking about in the parable of the sower or the parable of the seed in Matthew chapter 12. And he said Matthew 13. He said in Matthew 13, verse 22, the one who received the seed that fell among the thorns is the man who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke it, making it unfruitful. In other words, because of these forces and pressures of the world, you get distracted, you lose your focus, you become obsessed with things that you can see, and your spiritual priorities fade and diminish. And this causes conflict with God and with others. So conflict's cause is internal, but it's also external. Conflict's cure. Let's talk about that. And this is where we talk about fighting the right fight. Because really, if you're going to walk in the cure, you need to fight the right fight. You need to fight for things that God wants, that he's offering to us. Okay, so let's continue in James 4, beginning in verse 6 now. Listen to what he says. Talking about God, he says, but he gives us more grace. That's why the scripture says, God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Okay, put a pin in that. Because that's like kind of a startling statement. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. It's one thing to have God ignore you. It's another thing to have God oppose you. And who would ever want that? Nobody, of course. So he says this in verse 7, submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God and he will come near to you. Now brace yourselves, okay, because James is about to get real and raw and sort of straightforward. Listen to what he says. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter into mourning and your joy to gloom. And here's the humility thing again. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. So packed in these verses is conflict's cure, the things that we need to fight for if we're going to fight the right fight. Here's the first one. Fight for grace. Verse 6. But he gives us more grace. Can I tell you what? If the heart of the problem is a problem of the heart, there is only one cure, and it's the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the only thing that can transform the heart and heal the heart. Is the blood of Christ and the good news that Jesus died and rose again for our salvation. The one effective cure for conflict is grace. And God desires to give us more grace. I love how that starts. But he gives us more grace. I ran into this verse last week in Isaiah, and I'm telling you, there's sometimes when Bible verses just really grab you, right? And this verse in Isaiah last week really grabbed me, and I'm only going to give you one, but you should read the verses around it. Not now, later. But these are some amazing verses in Isaiah. But I love this. Chapter 30, verse 18. And this is in the middle of Isaiah prophesying to Israel in their rebellion towards God. So that's the relationship that they're having with God right now. They're in rebellion, open, active rebellion towards God. And listen to what Isaiah is prophesying. In chapter 30, verse 18, he says this, yet the Lord longs to be gracious to you. He rises to show you compassion, for the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all who wait for him. That's so good. He gives us more grace. That's God's posture towards you. That's his attitude towards you, especially as a child of God in Jesus. He wants to give you grace. That's sufficient. For daily needs, there's daily grace. For sudden need, there's sudden grace. For overwhelming need, there's overwhelming grace. And you have to fight for this because the enemy of your soul wants to tell you that you've sinned too much, you're beyond forgiveness, that broken relationship in your life is too damaged to be restored. Your current struggles are too hard. They cannot be overcome. You should consider giving up. But he gives us more grace. Wow, that's good news. Ask for it. Fight for it. Embrace it. The Lord longs to be gracious to you. Fight for grace. That's number one. In conflict's cure, here's the next fight. Fight for submission. Submitting to God. Okay? That's what James said. Submit yourselves then to God. And we surrender to him. And can I tell you that this is both a point when you come to Christ in salvation. There's this point of submission where you say, yep, I'm a sinner, I need a Savior, and I'm putting my trust in Jesus. That's the point. But then, submission is also a process. It's an ongoing, everyday, kind of in thought and word and deed, you're surrendering continually to the Lord. It's a process. That's why James can say it to the people in the body of Christ. And it's not a foolish, emotional impulse. It's not. It's the most rational, intelligent, reasonable, sensible thing you can do, submit to God. It's natural for us to want to be our own boss. That comes naturally. We need to fight to get to the place of surrender and submission. And a relationship with God through Christ is a relationship of ongoing surrender and ongoing submission. Psalm 143, verse 10. Listen to what the psalmist said. Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. May your good spirit lead me on level ground. That is a great prayer. God, continue to teach me. Continue to show me. I want to be a person that does your will. Matthew 6:10, Jesus, when he taught us to pray, he says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. This is our prayer, that God would have his will, his way in our lives. And that is a daily life of surrender and submission. Conflict's cure is found in fighting for submission. The third thing that James tells us is to fight for resistance. Right? Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. That's what James said in James 4. So you don't resist God, you resist the devil. Now when we talk about the devil, Satan, you know, we believe that the Bible teaches that he's a real entity, he's a real being. Now that's an admission, but should not become an obsession. You get the difference? We admit that there's a real enemy of our soul. He really exists, but we don't obsess over that. We don't say there's like a devil around every corner. Everything is the devil's fault. The devil made me do it. But this real spiritual enemy, we understand that his native language is lying and that his job description is to only kill, steal, and destroy. Jesus said that in John 10:10. The thief comes only, if I were to underline a word, I'd underline that word only. So this is a job description. He only comes to steal and kill and destroy. Thank God Jesus came to give us life, that we may have life and have it to the full. Ephesians chapter 6, 11 and 12, you're familiar with this. This is the armor of God passage. And Paul says, put on the full armor of God so that you can make your stand against who? The devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. So in conflict's cure, you know, we're not as concerned about the struggles we have between people. It's a spiritual battle that we're really concerned about. Our struggle's not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. And then we need to maintain the right perspective of the devil's power and position. He is not an equal and opposing force to God. He is a created being, and he's been defeated by the death of Jesus on the cross. He is a defeated enemy. Yes, he still has power. Yes, he still has influence. But God ultimately rules and reigns. 1 John 4:4, these are not on the screen, but you might remember these. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Romans 8:37, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Christ who loved us. In Romans chapter 16, verse 20, one of my favorite verses, and the God of peace shall soon crush Satan under your feet. I love it. Let's stomp some devil head in our walk with Jesus. We can do it. So the right fight is the fight for grace, the fight for submission, the fight for resistance. Here's the next one. Fight for pursuit. James 4, verse 8, come near to God and he will come near to you. Can I tell you what? This will be contested in your life because anything of spiritual value is going to encounter resistance. Anything of, you know, real positive spiritual value is going to encounter the resistance of that enemy we just talked about, and maybe even just your flesh or your circumstances. We need to fight for pursuit. Your quiet time with God, your prayer time, your devotional time, the ways that you connect with God. You know, and I talked about this before, but it always doesn't hurt to sometimes repeat things. I think you have three basic battles that you're fighting in, you know, trying to get to that coming near to God, drawing near to God. It's the battle of the blankets, the battle of the blahs, and the battle of belief. Okay? So the battle of the blankets, that's the problem of discipline. When you wake up in the morning, you say, good morning, Lord, or do you say, good Lord, it's morning? Right? Then there's the battle of the blahs. That's the problem of dryness. Like, you know, I just don't feel anything when I have my time with the Lord. It's just like so dry, and I don't know. It's hard for me to do it because I just don't get anything out of it. Can I tell you what? Don't ever judge your quiet time by your feelings. Do it anyway. Have time with God anyway. And then there's the battle of belief. Okay? That's the battle with discouragement. Because sometimes it feels like, and you know what? This is true for me, so maybe I'm the only one in the room, but I doubt it. Sometimes it feels like God's not hearing my prayers. Sometimes it feels like he's not answering my prayers. And so I get discouraged, and I feel sometimes like, you know, does God really love me? Does it make a difference when I pray? And I kind of stop believing in prayer. No, I don't stay there long. And you shouldn't stay there long. Because we battle through that. We pursue through it. This is the battle to pursue God, the presence of God. Draw near to the Lord, and he will draw near to you. Psalm 73:28 says, "But as for me, it is good to be near God. I have made the sovereign Lord my refuge." Psalm 145, verse 18 says, "The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth." God is near you if you draw near to him. Push through the opposition and fight for pursuit. Okay, the next one is fight for remorse. James says in chapter 4, verse 9, "Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom." This almost sounds like the opposite of what a Christian should be like. Right? We're always taught, you know, walk in hope and be a light and, you know, your strength is the joy of the Lord. And those things are true. You know, so this, what James is talking about, the grieving, the mourning, the wailing, changing your laughter to mourning, your joy to grieve, that's not the normal Christian mode of operation. That's not our MO. We should not be walking around like we've been baptized in lemon juice. Okay? But there is a right time to embrace the conviction of God and to understand that sometimes we fall short. And you know, when you're able to go deep in the experience of conviction and remorse, that oftentimes brings about lasting change in your life. I think that's what James is talking about. Fight for that place where you examine your heart and you allow the Lord to move in you in deep ways and in deep places. Do you remember when David sinned and he had an adulterous relationship with Bathsheba, and then he had Uriah the Hittite, her husband, murdered basically? And then Nathan the prophet confronted him. Do you remember that story? And you know what? When David finally realized that Nathan was talking about him, was talking about David, he really became broken. And when you read Psalm 51, the superscript above that psalm is a psalm of David after Nathan the prophet had spoken to him about, you know, his sin. And read the whole psalm. But I'm just going to pick out a couple verses, verses 10 to 12. David's crying out. I think he's just really embracing this. "Oh, my Lord, I have fallen short. I've sinned before you." And he says, "Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence and take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me." When you've wandered from God in some way or put yourself in opposition to him, fight for remorse. It's conflict's cure, for sure. All right, here's the last one. Fight for humility. Fight for humility. In James 4, verse 10, "Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up." I like the paraphrase version by Eugene Peterson. I don't have the exact way he phrases it, but it goes something like this. The way to get back on your feet is to get down on your knees. So humility, it's not thinking less of yourself. It's not beating yourself up. It's thinking about yourself less. It's marked by modesty in behavior and attitude and spirit. It's not arrogant. It's realizing your need for God. Jesus affirms what James is saying. Matthew chapter 23, verse 12. He says, whoever exalts himself will be humbled. Whoever humbles himself will be exalted. That sounds like what James just said. And so we humble ourselves before the Lord. That's how we fight for conflict's cure. We fight the right fight. Fight for grace, fight for submission, fight for resistance, fight for pursuit, fight for remorse, and fight for humility. Your relationship with God will be stronger, and your relationship with others will be stronger. So I'm going to have the worship team come back. And as we humbly come to communion, and I don't know if you've used these communion-type cups before, but there's actually two little things you have to pull. There's the first, a very thin cellophane that you pull to expose the wafer, and then you go down a little deeper and pull back the one for the juice. We're going to share communion in a minute, but first I want to sing this closing song, or at least the first part of it. Because Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and this connects well with what we're talking about tonight or today, 1 Corinthians 11, 28 to 30, says, a man ought to examine himself before he eats the bread and drinks the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. And he's not talking about falling asleep in church. It's a euphemism for people that have died. I mean, we need to take this seriously, okay? When we share communion together, when we remember what Jesus has done for us by sharing the elements of the bread and the cup. The song we're going to sing is called At the Cross. And I love how this connects with God's grace, but also our need for surrender. God knows you. God knows your failures. God knows your shortcomings. But he still loves you. He loves you so much. He went all the way to the cross for you. I just want you to think about that as, and maybe the song is new to you, but it's easy to catch on to. As we sing this together, before we share together, will you just kind of think about that? You have fallen short, but Jesus has come to give you new life. All right, let's sing it together.
Oh, Lord, you've searched me, and you know. Even when I fail you, I know you love me. Your holy presence surrounding me. In every season, I know you love me. I know you love me. At the cross, I bow my knee, where your blood was shed for me. There's no greater love than this. You have overcome the grave. Your glory fills the highest place. What can separate me now?
Yeah. Hallelujah.
You
go before me. If you go before me, you shield my way, and your hand upholds me, and I know you love me. At the cross I bow my knee, where your blood was shed for me. There's no greater love than this. You have overcome the grave. Your glory fills the highest place. What can separate me now? And at the cross I bow my knee, where your blood was shed for me. There's no greater love than this. You have overcome the grave. Your glory fills the highest place. What can separate me now?
First Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, Paul reminds us, he said, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" You can take the wafer and we'll eat together. Thank you, Jesus. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let us drink together. Thank you, Lord. We know that power was released when Jesus died on the cross. Remember the story on that Good Friday? The earth turned dark in the middle of the day for 3 hours. It says that graves and tombs were opened up and dead people came out alive. In the temple, there was the thick curtain that separated the Holy of Holies from the rest of the temple. And it says the curtain was torn in two, and I think this is important, from the top to the bottom. Right? It wasn't somebody at the bottom saying, "Yeah, now we can tear the curtain." It was God alone that tore that curtain in two from the top to the bottom. He tore the veil. He makes a way for us. When Jesus said, "It is finished," it is done. Amen. Will you stand with me? We're going to sing the rest of this song together. Then we'll pray and let you go.
You tore the veil. You made a way. When you said that it is done, you tore the veil, you made a way. When you said that it is done, you tore the veil, you made a way. When you said that it is done, you tore the veil, you made a way. When you said that it is done, and when the earth fades, falls from Your glory fills the highest place. What can separate me now?
At the cross.
At the cross I bow my knee. Where your blood was shed for me. There's no greater love than this. And you have overcome the grave. Your glory fills the highest place. What can separate us now?
So as we go to prayer before we send you on your way today, I see Shannon's up front. If you have a need for personal prayer, she'd be happy to pray with you, to connect with you. Mary's on this side. So if you need prayer, if you're online, you can make a note on the Facebook platform, and we'd be happy to connect with you in prayer. But, you know, what fight are you in right now, or what fight should you be engaging right now in your life in order to come closer to Christ? Do you need to fight for more grace? Do you need to fight for submission and surrender? Do you need to fight for resisting the devil? Do you need to fight for pursuit to come near to God and believe that he comes near to you? Do you need to fight for remorse? Is there a place in your life where you just need to embrace conviction and go to the deep places with God and let him do a transforming work in your life? Do you need to fight for humility? It is the proper response when we come to the Lord and realize what he has done for us. We surrender to him. Jesus says, if you want to follow me, you need to deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow me. So God, help us to do that. All right? So let's pray together. Lord God, thank you for the good news. It's always good news. It rules and reigns supreme in our minds. And it rules and reigns supreme over any work of the enemy in our lives. So thank you, God. We just want to fight the right fight. We want to see our relationship with you strong and thriving. And we want to see our relationship with others in a healthy place, in a healthy way, so that we can reflect you well. Help us, God. We pray for blessing today over the marriages represented in this room and all those who are listening, the families, the circumstances and situations, Lord, help us, oh God. Help us to be overcomers and to glorify you with our lives. You have provided a way through what you've done on the cross. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. All God's people said, amen. All right, God bless you.
Show me truth about myself so I know how to follow you. Sing this prayer with us.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true.
Sing that again. Here's my heart.
Here's my heart, Lord.
Can you pray that to him?
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord.
Speak truth, Lord.
Speak what is true.
I am found.
Here's my